Here we go, guys. This is the big moment. NA versus EU. Gale Force Esports versus Mindsanity. Welcome back to the Heroes of the Storm Summer Championship live from the Monster Energy DreamHack Studios here in Stockholm, Sweden. And with me, of course, at the analyst desk now, we have wonderful people. Unfortunately, they're all from an A now, so I feel kind of outnumbered. Wait, okay, Wolf is Korean.
I'm Korea. Right, there okay, you can put the Korean flag next to my name.
I'd just like to say the tides are now turned after you guys were on me last time. I'm just saying.
All right, Gilly, welcome to the analyst desk here for the first time. How are you doing today?
I'm doing great. I was just about to ask you, how are you feeling up here with all of us here?
Well, I'm feeling more intimidated by J-Ho, unfortunately, most importantly.
I'm intimidating.
Clearly.
I'm not as intimidating on this panel. If Korea were here, you guys would be looking at me a little bit scared. But yeah, I guess I am from America originally, so I've got that one of the three American trio we've got up here on this panel. Sorry, Kendrick, you're the lone EU boy over there.
No worries, I got you covered. Okay, so J-Hal, one more time. Are you excited about this upcoming best of three? I mean, sure you are, but tell us how excited you are.
Yeah, I think the fact that what we saw from Gale Force the other day wasn't indicative of what they can pull off. And now this is like their first true test outside of NA. They're going up against Mindsanity. Now, they took down Cloud9 a couple times in qualifiers, and they defeated Niventic just last week during regionals to qualify to get here. But this is Mindsanity. This is completely different than what they're used to. They don't have the same type of experience. That is what I'm looking for.
Yeah, and before we go to the first conclusions here about this upcoming best of three, of course, we're going to take a little bit of a broader look on what happened on the road to the Heroes of the Storm Summer Championships. All the different regions have sent their elite teams to compete for this title of the Summer World Champion. And once again, we have to say that it is getting closer and closer to the second group stage, which of course means that the teams that have been seed one or seed number one for the major regions will be waiting for the upcoming rivaling teams here. And of course, Niventic, Tempest, E-Star, and Dignitas, those teams are no easy obstacle to overcome, Gilly.
They are no easy obstacle, but when you're even looking at a team like Mindsanity, who maybe started the first regional for EU looking not so dominant, their performance at the second EU regional was insane. They didn't drop a single game. To me, they look like the more dominant of the two EU teams, even though they're in this position.
Yeah. J-Hal, we mentioned that Mindsanity was very dominant, but we also have to take a look at the bracket here, by the way, once again. The winner of this next best of three is going to make it to Jönköping in Sweden for DreamHack Summer. This is basically where all the real action is going to start. This is where it goes for prize money, for the big prize money, for glory and honor, of course. And the loser of this match will drop down to face PBA, who haven't really looked that shabbily, did they, Wolf?
Oh, no, looking really strong, looking a lot better than they did on day one. And I do have to say, the cool thing about both of these regions is the reason why these teams were not seeded actually directly into Jönköping, as you mentioned, is because they actually were from the second qualifiers. So
correct,
they both actually defeated the first seed for America. So in a way, these teams are the most current champions of their region. So this is really exciting because it's basically the top most recent NA champion versus the top most recent EU champion. So there's a big storyline here. The big rivalry always is between EU and NA, and who's going to come out today?
And talking about a little bit of an upset or a rivalry, J-Hal, you are from NA. You witnessed the last regionals in Burbank in the U.S. Can you tell us like what happened exactly between Niventic and Gale Force Esports? Because this is where Gale Force Esports were skyrocketed into everybody's attention.
It's almost like a phenomenon that's happened. I mean, you got to think, this Gale Force roster actually came together just in April, like the second week or first week in April. So to see how drastically they've improved in just a month and a half, I mean, it was, I think, 7 weeks from the time that they formed to the time that they took down Niventic to qualify for Worlds. That kind of, I guess, grouping and then improvement is kind of unheard of in the scene. A lot of continuity helps, but the fact that they're here shows that they have the potential.
Yeah.
Can they? I mean, it's almost like we're literally watching them grow as a team. We're watching every step of their growth. If they make another step here, that would be super impressive.
Gilly, anything to add to that? Why does Gale Force Esports excel in this very tour? Why are they?
They may look like a new team, which they are, but one thing that they have is they have players who have been in the scene for a very long time.
Yeah.
Michael Udall and Akaface took second place at the first Heroes of the Dorm and ended up winning the whole thing. Crowan has been playing on a team for a long time and was one of the best players, if not the best on that team. He is so amazing. Yeah, Fury has been one of the oldest Heroes of the Storm North American players ever. He was on the first Curse team and then a Murloc Geniuses for a full year. And then Rafflecopter, yeah, he played on Team Blaze for a long time. And so they have all of these players, playmakers in some right, from different mid-tier teams coming together. And they knew what they were looking for in a team, which is why they were able to come in and just quickly dominate.
All right, guys, let's actually focus a little bit more on Galeforce Esports. They were looking a little bit wonky and tired 2 days ago because of their travel issues, but they have had one entire day to regain some strength, and this is how they prepared themselves for this tournament.
The goal coming into this tournament is to do as well as possible. It's our, we've only been a team for a couple of months and it's our first international event. So we're hoping for around maybe between fifth to eighth, somewhere around that range.
I think there's a lot to learn here. I think it's a big jump from going from just North America to the world stage. I think there's something a lesson to learn from every team here. Biggest factor, I think, would be experience right now. I think if you trust your shot caller, if you guys synergize really well together, I think that's going to give you an advantage over the other teams.
I think how we all get along with each other. We were only a team for a day and we almost qualified for Austin, DreamHack Austin, and then we ended up qualifying the next week. We just got along really well, really fast, and we've just been growing constantly, at a really good rate.
I think it's important to adjust to the drafting, seeing what other regions like to play, and then you have to adjust what heroes you pick first compared to them.
I think a lot of it for our team personally will boil down to trusting, not trusting, but on Michael's shot calling. I think if he has really good shot calling days and we're all feeling it and all playing really well, then that's gonna mean our team's gonna do really well.
That was Galeforce Esports for you, and we have to say, while we're waiting for them to actually show on screen, that, of course, they are basically a bunch of cool fellas. They all get a well with each other, and they are good friends, not only in-game, but also out of the battlefield.
Yeah, Rafflecopter has talked before about how, all of them really have, about how important that is to them, is their synergy. I have a model for them, which is Live Together, Die Alone. When they are working together as a cohesive unit, they have synergy that is nearly unmatched. It is really beautiful to see, especially for a team that is just so young. But they all respect each other, and they know that that's something that's good for them.
I feel like it's really important to note that they came up with a lot of other North American teams that are kind of trying to rise in, Astral Authority, Brainpower, these other teams that kind of all started to form around the same time. And it's Galeforce, actually, that was able to emerge. They did well in Austin, as Crowan said. He's we made the turn, just the team right before the tournament, we almost won, and then they win the second one. They're coming up so quickly, and I think it comes from that experience that you mentioned, especially the Heroes of the Dorm experience that two of their most important players have.
Yeah, Dorm was so important to them, too, because it really improved Michael Udall's shot calling. He had not been a shot caller before then, but knew he needed to be for his Dorm team. And so he studied so hard. He took a break from the professional scene just so he could improve that.
Yeah, and by the way, guys, we're still working on these technical issues here, of course. It shouldn't really take that long, we hope. So just bear with us a little bit, and we're... Yeah, there we go. Okay, all right, so everything's working.
Our monitor's still coming back around.
Apparently everything's working, just the monitor for us here are having a little bit of a fluke here and playing mind games with us. But Jayhaw, of course, Galeforce Esports, they are a solid five-man unit, but is there a leading figure that you can make out from these five dudes?
I think that's the biggest thing that I actually wanted to talk about. And this is something that you can actually, I don't know if it's picking it up, but they're having a good time over there preparing.
They're cracking up.
But one person I wanted to speak to, that gentleman right there, Michael Udall, okay? He's dabbing. He's having a good time. He's up all the time. It's one of the most positive people. Look at how much fun they're having. Now, here's the thing. When they face adversity, he does not fold. He does not fold at all. He keeps his team calm, he keeps them collected, and he gets them back on point. But at the same time, they rely heavily on him.
Yeah.
Now, there's a difference in this matchup to where I see Gale Force, they rely heavily on his shot calls, where my Insanity, while they have a shot caller, they tend to be able to be a little bit more flexible and improvise from the other people, where Gale Force,
oh,
because
wing,
they're so
though.
Fresh.
Akafe's always down for some jokes here as well.
Where's
and
that,
of course, oh.
Where's it at? Oh,
where's
no,
it,
we're not doing
it.
Where's it at?
There he is.
Crowing, man. We can actually say that.
Oh, yeah. Best hair, by the way, in esports. Best hair.
Do you know why
in
he
esports.
Has that streak?
Tell me.
Because he made a bet that UT Arlington was going to be ASU and Heroes of the Dorm. By the way, ASU, two of them are his teammates, so we bet against them, and he actually followed through on the bet and dyed that streak in his hair.
I think it looks really good.
It's awesome.
If I had to be totally real.
How many years have you been in esports, Wolf? And for you to say that, that actually means
a
lot, doesn't it?
Yeah, I've been about 6 years. I'm probably like the hair expert in all of esports, coming from StarCraft, now moving into Heroes of the Storm. So it means a lot to say this. Best hair. Of all time. But I want to go back to something really quick before we move into my Insanity, is what you were talking about, how Mike Udall is the one who holds things together. And I think that was really tested when he was actually stuck in having travel problems and showed up later than the rest of his team, came in here tired, without rest, and they had a tough time against Big Gods, but he pulled it together. And that's really, really important. And it does prove, yet again, the kind of the whole idea we're talking about is how he is the leader and they do follow him.
Right, let's now focus on their European counterpart, however. My Insanity, the reigning European champions, if you will, after Tours France, they are not an easy obstacle to overcome, and they are definitely ready to take on the fight.
Our goal, or my goal, is to, of course, win the whole tournament. But it's not going to be easy, as we know that the Asian teams, especially MVP Black and Easter, are very strong. So reaching top four is probably our goal, but I want to win the whole thing.
I actually think Splendor. It's pretty important, like the support has a really huge role in this game, I think, and if he hits his stuff or not can, or it counts for every player, but for the support especially, if he hits his ability, it can turn a complete team fight around and it can secure the game.
So in our team, we actually don't have a single shot caller, we are all shot calling together, which leads to everyone having sometimes like really good shot calls in certain situations. And I think overall in Heroes you need to have good shot callers. It might be the whole team or might be a single person, because it's all about team synergy. So if we all do the same thing together with the same idea and understanding what to do, then usually leads to victory. We can basically pick any hero in the game, so I think very hard to outdraft us. And like, no matter what happens in the draft, we will get heroes that we can play. And I think some of the teams or players still have a very small hero pool, so we have no problem with that, which makes us strong.
Alright guys, we just mentioned that Gale Force Esports' biggest strength is of course their mental stability, guys. If you had to name a biggest strength of my Insanity, J-Hal, what would it be?
You know, I was trying to make the point before about the shot calling, is the fact that my Insanity, and he talked about it in that interview, the fact that, and when I said they have a shot caller, I meant like every single one of them, because I actually talked to them this morning and last night, in the sense that if you watch their play, one person can make a move, or they can use a heroic, and their team follows suit without hesitation. They are on the same level as each other, and it is beautiful play to watch. If you're going to watch a team and you want to be able to learn and improve on teamwork, this is the team.
That comes in from a team that has been together for a while. It takes a while to develop that just mental link between players, but My Insanity has it. This roster has been together a long time, and they have such amazing flexibility too.
Yeah, something that I've always known of My Insanity ever since they formed as a Heroes of the Storm team is that they constantly feed each other information throughout the entire game. My cooldown's up. I used my E. You know, I just so everyone knows, 1 minute till boss, like just constantly giving information. Everyone's talking, but they're keeping it efficient. And efficiency, I think, is the middle name of my insanity.
German efficiency.
That's
that,
right.
If I may want to point that one out. But you mentioned a very good point there, Wolf. Not only is their communication very well executed, but it's also very, you know, you can admire that because they have four German-speaking people and only one person from Bulgaria, which is, of course, Splendor, and they still managed to get good communication done in English.
The thing that was relayed to me was the fact that they all play a lot of heroes. And they were talking about if, like, somebody's on Vikings, they said they have four people that play Vikings. And one person could say, hey, you go here. And they're able to communicate with each other because their hero pool is so deep, they're so diverse. And that communication between them, like, they were talking about a Lunara Wisp because they have people play, several people play Lunara. And everybody's like, hey, maybe you should move it here. And they can communicate. And it's actually really fun to listen to their mentality. And it's really fun to watch them play.
Flexibility, long-standing roster, communication. There are so many strengths to my insanity. But the one that stands out to me is how hardworking they are.
Yeah,
they are straight up known as the hardest working team in Europe. And right now, they're showing us why. As I said before, Team Dignitas, also a very strong team. But this is the team that has been, in my opinion, looking incredibly dominant and maybe the best chance to take down some of our Asian teams.
Can I just note that in Gale Force's interview, they said, we're hoping 5th to 8th. My insanity? They said,
they won the whole thing. Yeah, they want to win the whole
thing.
Do
you see the difference?
Yeah. I think it comes a lot of it to, sorry to cut you off there, but it comes a lot of it to how much experience some of these members of My Insanity have, especially Haswabs, who, if you talk about, if we put focus on one player on Galeforce, but when you look at My Insanity, Haswabs has been in esports for so long, like probably a decade at this point. He's played so many games, he's played Warcraft 3 at the highest level, one of the best German Starcraft 2 players, and then coming now into Heroes of the Storm, best European team, at least the most recent team to win the regional. And the hero pool that he has is incredible. The hero pool that everyone has on this team is so strong that it's so hard to outdraft them, and that's one of their greatest strengths.
I mean, Haswabs plays Kalfas, he plays Abathur, he plays other specialists. I mean,
Vikings.
The Vikings, right? You name it, and he's got it. It is impossible to predict the hero pool of this guy, and especially his Sagara performance during the regionals in Tours France were insane. But let's actually jump over to the predictions here, Wolf. We're going to start with you. We're not going to jump to prediction first.
It's over.
No, it's not. We're not going that fast. We just first need to get the maps. I'm getting all anxious and excited here, but let's actually move on to the maps first here, guys, and see which battleground is going to be played first. Okay.
Finally.
Infernal Shrines, guys. That is the most popular map that we've got in the current roster, in the current pool. J-Hell, what do you make of it?
This is one that I think we need to watch out for. Now, when we talked to, I think it was Rafflecopter yesterday, he said we're taking away Karazim. The problem is, if you first ban Karazim, you know who else they play on this map who's very effective? Diablo. And Diablo works really well on this map. So I feel that this map lends itself to a battle of the minds in draft.
Yeah, I feel like the flexibility for My Insanity is really going to come into play here, specifically on Infernal Shrines. We could see something like a Stitches. Of course, Blumbeam is known for his Johanna, play, but I don't think that that's out of the realm of possibility, and that's something that we see quite a bit, especially from Europe, maybe even sometimes from MVP Black. I know they played Stitches on this map.
No, absolutely. Every now and then it does come into play. My biggest take at looking at that map pool is we don't see Cursed Hollow in it at all, and that's actually one of the maps that we see Galeforce use a lot. Crowan loves the map, but we're going to jump into this first draft right away.
Yeah, there this we go. Tassadar being banned, Illidan being banned, and you want to say something,
No, I'm just saying, this is far more than what we're used to. Having Tassadar banned out first with Illidan makes so much more sense, but that does lend Zul to be on the board.
Yeah, and Zul, of course, one of the strongest split pushers, of course, and of course has a lot of AoE damage as well if he goes for that Poison Nova. Always a big threat for the enemy support, because if you have someone like, you know, an Uther, he can't necessarily deal with that.
What has amazed me from these drafts, and we saw this even in the first set Galeforce was doing, is the minute they get to the world stage, they're prioritizing Kael'thas over Li Ming. They're realizing that this is the hero that is making the plays for a lot of teams, including them.
And that's why I was actually going to go back to the Cursed Hollow being out of the picture, because I think one of the reasons why they're so strong on that map is because of Crowan's Li Ming, and the fact that they don't pick it and they use Kael'thas here means that they want to rely on that later on in the tournament. They can. It's going to be tougher for the rest of the teams to study them, but they're already moving away from that reliance. With two strong laners here with Sonya and Zul, I'd like to see an ETC pickup somewhere in this draft, because you can punish those rotations on this map, you can power slide in, and get aggressive in the early game.
I think that we've seen Stitches in the EU region on Infernal Shrines, but also so Diablo.
There's the ETC. I'm loving this pick, guys.
ETC, you know, he's a good hero, as you mentioned, Wolf, to sort of initiate big plays, the wombo combos, of course. But is there another reason why you prefer this ETC against what Mindsanity has brought to the table so far?
Well, I just feel like what we're seeing here, wow, the Kerrigan ban coming down. That's not what I expected here.
Right.
But just to kind of close that thought, like, when Zul is rotating between two lanes and constantly pushing, you go for the ETCs of the power slide.
These are teams that know each other. Michael Udall, known for Kerrigan, NA known to play Kerrigan on Infernal Shrines, like the only map. Diablo, known to be played by My Insanity. They know each other. These teams have studied.
They have, but the ETC is a little concerning for me, although I do agree that with the composition, it's great. They did not play ETC at all in the second regional. And while it is good for this composition, it fits something that Fury is less comfortable on. We've seen ETC can get blown up really fast, and there's potential for lockdown from My Insanity. And yep, Splendor again getting his Karazim. Yeah. No surprise there.
Does this lend to, okay, so if you've got basically a triple front line between Zul, Sonya, Karazim, they still have to go with a true warrior? I mean, they don't have to, but they have to go with a true warrior. That's four frontline heroes against the potential mosh pit coming out.
And against the Kel'Thas.
And against the Kel'Thas.
Do you think that's the strategy there? And do you think the Mighty Gust might be the disengage needed?
I mean, the Mighty Gust is so crucial when it comes to, you know, to sort of get rid of those mosh pits when they start to hitting your guys. But as you mentioned, J-Hell, I mean, the AoE potential, the living bomb spread potential here for Galeforce Esports is looking very scary.
Not only that, but again, I go back to the build that the MVP Black plays a lot on Infernal Shrines versus a heavy melee composition, and that is that Q build for his Flame Strike. If you can get My Insanity grouped up, you could do so much damage once you pick up Burning Flash, and even Fury of the Sun while at 16.
And that's how Crowan's been actually playing Kael'thas so far this tournament, and it's somewhat of a greedy way to play, but if it pays off in big dividends. I'm wondering if My Insanity might even consider Tyrael as a fifth pick here. I know it's not really the way Europe likes to play it compared to Asia, but that's something I'd be thinking about, as we do see Sylvanas come out here as kind of a wave pusher.
Yeah,
for Galeforce.
The thing I love most about Sylvanas against the heavy melee comp, are they really going Abathur?
Okay.
That didn't make as much sense. But the thing that I love about Sylvanas, and I honestly feel like it's almost impossible to go away from this, especially against a heavy melee comp like My Insanity, is her level 4 Lost Soul talent, which has the cooldown reduction on her Shadow Dagger. The more people it spreads to, the shorter the cooldown. And I think that's one of the huge things that we'll be able to see out of Sylvanas. So look for her to actually be able to contribute quite a bit to these team fights.
Yeah, besides the team fights, the objective. If they can pick up those Punishers, she'll be able to get far more out of it because she can set down the structures, which means you're relying on a lot of melee heroes to try to take down a Punisher, while meanwhile you've got Kael'thas like Living Bomb to you, and you get a Living Bomb, and you get hit by a Flame Strike.
What do you make of this last pick, Anubarak, here? I mean, it is not something that, you know, you would have expected, maybe a Tyrael with the Sanctification. You mentioned that, Wolf. What do you make of this?
It offers a lot of disruption. And on this map, sometimes, especially when you go for invades on the mercenary camps, if you get stuck in that little ring that, you know, the mercs are actually inside of, you can get three-man stuns twice. You can impale them, then you can burrow charge in and get the second stun off. You can kind of link those together. I do kind of like that that lends itself to a big whirlwinds coming in and Strong initiates in fights.
Yeah.
But I think this game is really going to be decided by the ETC in the early game, if I had to be totally honest.
Is this a battle of regional meta, or is this map? Because Muradin? Not in this game. And we've seen Muradin highly prioritized for the first three games.
Especially Galeforce. That is their most highly prioritized warrior. We hardly ever see Fury off of Muradin.
Is this a regional thing, or is this a map thing, or is this the we need to study?
Either way, this is going to be an extremely cool draft in a game as well.
Yeah.
And I can't wait to hear you guys' prediction about this. Wolf, let's actually start over with you.
Oh, I really think it's going to come down to the ETC, but I'm going to give it to My Insanity. I think with the Sonya and the Zul, they're going to control the early game and snowball this into a win.
All right, thank you.
I'm going to say Galeforce just because we need some variety here, but also I think the Kael'thas is going to get a lot of value out of them. I'm going to be very optimistic.
Definitely a
Kendrick.
Fair point, Gilly.
Sylvanas, Kael'thas alone, sell me on Galeforce Esports.
All right, and last but not least, of course, I also have to make a prediction. I'm just going to say this: who wants to ride a Chevy when you can go with a BMW? So, I mean, let's be honest here. My point is on My Insanity. I think they will take this game number one. I love the Anubarak pick. Let's see how it goes. Let's also see what our casting duo has to offer for you guys at home in front of the computer. Kalaris and Dr. Dredd, take us to this highly anticipated game number one.
thank you very much, guys, over at the desk, and welcome to the caster's desk for what is sure to be a fantastic game to start things off here. Dread, my insanity going up against Gale Force Esports, the first time the NA and EU have met one another in this tournament so far, and it's going to be interesting to see what goes down.
Yeah, both of these teams actually not doing too well in their first regional. I guess my insanity did end up getting second, but when it came to overall, both of them did win the second regional rather convincingly compared to a majority of the other teams.
All right, let's get into it. Gale Force Esports to the left-hand side with Mike Udall going to be playing Thrall, Rufflecopter on Sylvanas, Fury on ETC, Crowan on Kael'thas, and Rengar on Rengar being played by Akaface, not Rengar on Akaface. And then over to the right-hand side is My Insanity with Nurok playing Zul, Darkmog playing Sonya, Splendor playing Karazim, Falstad playing by Hasu Obs, and Blumby will be on Anubarak.
Already, My Insanity is deciding to mix up the going head-to-head in the mid lane. Meanwhile, Gale Force is going to try and get the minion block. They do that quite often, so no surprise with this. My Insanity has a great composition when it comes to the wave clear and control. Azul and Sonya are going to be able to do a lot when it comes to Infernal Shrines here. So Gale Force really needs to make sure that they understand the circumstances and make the adjustments accordingly.
And just to make a note of that as well, they've got to be careful about doing that minion block from game to game, because Europe has been known to exploit that by just knowing that a team's going to do it,
yeah,
and then just going to a tower and killing it. So you do have to be a little bit wary about doing that from time to time.
Yeah, and the wave clear on the side of Gale Force is very good, so they end up making the rotation from mid to bottom here. Just kind of dancing between the two lanes for the time being, nobody gaining any too big of an advantage. The 1v1 being with between the melee assassins here. Yeah. So far, very standard.
Yeah, man, it's a very slow start, not too much aggression on either side. Looking at the drafts yourself, do you kind of give a bit of sway to either one? Are you impressed by how Gale Force have been able to approach this?
I'm impressed from Gale Force's draft, not so much what they drafted, but the adjustments they made. They are a very young team, and I'm surprised that they made a lot of major adjustments in their draft compared to what they would do in North America. At the same time, I feel like My Insanity, without a doubt, got what they wanted. Sonya Zul very early in the draft is something that's going to be really hard for GFE to deal with.
And not the most conventional style of aggression there, but instantly plowing down one tower very quickly up to the top here. Mike Udall had no room to really respond to that. Blumby going to move towards the bottom here, zone out Fury for a little moment, but they know that the majority of Gale Force is down towards the bottom, so zoning them from that location for a little bit means that they have a bit of control across that Shrine at the moment.
Yeah, and so you can expect Sylvanas is going to be trying to clear the waves on the side, while Zul is going to be doing the exact same. You see them isolating, but now when you consider on the Shrine here, the wave clear that Darkmok is going to be able to have over, for instance, Mike Udall and everybody taking the damage for Gale Force. This is why their composition is just so dominant for My Insanity, but Blumby gets caught out there.
Very, very close to death. He will burrow charge away there for the moment. Going to have to tap or even just, it looks like he does have tap available, so he's going to come right back on in. Darkmog takes some damage. Gale Force Esports have done a great job of pushing them off the Shrine.
Yeah, they really have done a decent job here. Akafe's going to be getting stunned out. Both the teams from the specialist from the bottom lane, Soaking, has actually moved up. Every team's worried about the Shrine, but the combo.
Oh, that's a great Verdant Sphere. Gravity laps on towards two. It's going to Hasselobs has to move away. Likewise, at the same time, Mike Udall will go down. That's first blood. Throw a little bit far forward. Blumby trying to body block on towards Rufflecopter there. Didn't have a Haunting Wave available, but will survive for now.
Yeah, and both teams now 25-25 when it comes to the Skeletal Defenders. But again, a man up for My Insanity. They should be able to close this out here. Gale Force is going to rotate and try and get the soak here. So already, again, that double melee for My Insanity working out really well. And Blumby with the aggression has done a great job. Those spikes hitting multiple members. I think he even had a four-man there with the second one.
And important to note, then, when the draft comes to play as well, is that Chrome wasn't allowed Li Ming because of the map more so than anything else, right? He's much more comfortable on that than Kael'thas, I would say, looking at his previous games in the NA regionals, but being on Kael'thas, it's not exactly a disadvantage because he's a very good hero.
Yeah, no, he's kind of like, I view him as like the Mene of North America. He's very much known for the mages, so it isn't the one that he kind of came to fame with,
big
plays, but he is very good at just mages in general, so I don't think it's going to be too big of a problem, but the map complements the Kael'thas.
All right, well, that's My Insanity doing well to start things off. Of course, a lot of that experience advantage that they have is in that tower that they took up towards the top and the one kill on Thrall, but it is pushing them towards seven a little bit quicker. And also, as a minor point, while this game has just calmed down a little bit, Nurok's the happiest person alive that they banned Sassadar out first, because he despises playing it and he owns his hands up on it. So him on Zul, he's a very happy panda right now, is Nurok.
Yeah, that's good to hear. From them. Gale Force did manage to get a camp here, getting a little bit of pressure. not trying, being able to abuse anything with this. During this time, they definitely want to be trying to get a turret or a pick on their opponents if they make a poor rotation. Splendor face checking the scroll.
Oh.
That's going to be 1-2. The stun knockup. He's not going to be able to survive. Splendor will be going down here for Galeforce. And they got now the pick and a little bit of pressure that they were looking to get.
Yep. Good moves there by Galeforce. Karazim going a little bit too far forward. And Mike Udall will just chase down Darkmog for the moment, but that'll just continue on for eternity. It's not like anybody's going to die up there on a 1v1 unless Galeforce were to rotate around. But My Insanity do have good vision on everybody else on the map.
Thrall is maintaining the soak. So is Aquaface here again. You see the wave clear that My Insanity has is applying a lot of pressure in each of these lanes. So far, they haven't been able to get too much out of it. Only a minor advantage when it comes to XP. Galeforce now picking up the Shaman Camp. My Insanity also with the mirrored response here. Knowing that the next temple is going to be spawning soon, these teams want to try and hopefully get some split pressure.
Yeah, always very nice to actually have this pushing up towards the top. I suppose if you leave Sylvanas up there for a little while to deal with it, it would be all right. But at the same time, Falstad is far more valuable in these situations.
Yeah, not only is Falstad more valuable in this situation, obviously with his almost complete global, but also Sylvanas doesn't do well in that 1v1. Falstad has a large amount of single target damage output, but they do get the engage here. Fury trying to make something happen. Darkmox trying to spin to win out here.
And he will get away.
Yeah.
Blumby likewise had to tunnel away as well. But they do have tap available, so they can get back into this. Falstad needs to come down. Zul was wave clearing towards the middle. They were getting good soak while this was going on. They're not going to be 10 during the shrine, I don't think. But here comes Falstad. Doesn't have much mana. Let's see how much of an effect he can have.
Raffle's isolation here really going to hurt the team. Haunting wave away. But yeah, as you said, Falstad actually managed to clear the Shaman Camp. So the longer this goes, the better. But the stun's coming out. Claire is already getting a pick here.
Great blow up on towards Zartmok. That means that Blumby's going to have to tunnel on out of there as well. The front line is a bit more exposed and a bit more weak without Sonya on that shrine, spinning, being able to collect some of that health while doing damage to them. But at least they get level 10. But once again, Galeforce Esports, good responses to what was going down. And there they will take that Punisher.
Yeah, and the Shaman Camp is now pushing still. Nobody's going to be able to get a response for Galeforce Esports. They're trying to abuse Sylvanas with the Punisher here. They do bait it over wall, getting the effectiveness. But without level 10, Galeforce really can't do too much right now. Also, Thrall is now soaking the top.
Poison Nova been taken instead of Skeletal Mages. We've seen it back and forth in this game, in this tournament at the moment, and all the usual suspects across the board elsewhere, with Cocoon really falling out of favor ever since the changes to Anubarak. So that will be Locust Swarm.
Galeforce has done a really good job in this game to make up for... I felt like when it came to the Shaman Camping, having a global in the upper half, they weren't going to be able to capitalize on Falstad's lack of presence when it came to the Shrine. But they've done a pretty good job so far in this game. Blumby getting caught out a bit there. Great cleanse, but I don't know if it's going to matter. Palm is burnt as well. They get on the cap, but the Gust.
Oh, and they're going to take it anyway here. So, yeah, responses coming out from Galeforce. Galeforce have actually shown fantastic little responses
yes.
from some of the things that we've seen so far. A night and day from the day that they arrived here and were admittedly a little bit tired and worse for wear, but now look at how well rested they are. They're bringing the fight to My Insanity.
I'm impressed, and it feels like that solo tank Anubarak pick, even though they do have a large amount of threats in single target, actually Sonya's going to be caught out as
She's
well
dead.
From the combo. There is no palm. She will be falling down, and it's like, the solo tank of Anubarak is very vulnerable to the combo that they have. And that's also another thing we've seen trending through this tournament, is it feels like the ETC Kael'thas is a far higher priority than Murder.
Is it the thing, like, looking at these fights that have gone down so far, though, My Insanity, every time they're taking these fights, it's like one of their three frontline members is just kind of getting picked off. And they don't really have their three frontline component taking a fight on their terms yet.
Yeah, that is definitely the case here. Keep in mind, Thrall is not with them in this team fight here. Fury's going to try and make something happen. Pre-cleanse comes out along with the Wailing Arrow, Kalaris.
Yeah, crashes two of them towards the back. Blumby at the front, though, is fine. Sonya will join them in just a little bit, as we do have Thrall straying up towards the top. Just in case a fight was to break out, they will fall back to their easy camp. And this is actually a brilliantly timed easy camp, considering that Shrine is just activated towards the top.
Yeah, so now these teams almost on absolutely even footing for the time being. All look like they're going to make the rotation to the upper half of the map. 13 and is... even for both these teams when it comes to whether or not they're going to be able to approach it. Zul is staying to get the clear here, so Galeforce has a small time to try and capitalize on their advantage.
Sunny wants to fight on their terms. The three frontliners together are strong, but solo can be picked off very easily. We've seen those gravity lapses into full kills go very fast on towards Darkmok. Blumby, Nurok yet to be a sacrifice for that, as Dartmar just cleaning up some of those towards the top. ETC is going to slide forward. There's a great gravity lapse on towards two of them. And oh my god, the palm just barely is able to go off there on towards Plumpy. No follow-up damage on towards him at all. But they push them back so easily. Gale Force is taking these fights furiously.
Yeah, and Darkmog now getting isolated with Fury there. Poison Nova and Gust use it at the same time. Everybody seems to be going down, but Darkmog is going to be the first to fall. Splinter is not able to keep everybody up here. Gale Force is doing a great job just chaining their CC. And with all the melees that you see for Mindsanity, they just can't deal with the damage.
Do you remember when I was like, yeah, Kron's not on Leaming. I don't know if he's going to do well. He's killing it on Kael'thas right now.
Yes, he is.
He is absolutely killing it. He is hitting the right Verdant Sphere Gravity Lapse he needs to. There's always a Flame Strike under it, and all the follow-up damage that's coming out from Gale Force is on point, Dredd.
Yeah, and Gale Force now is backing out, taking the Shaman Camp, going to be stacking that with the minor advantage they got, but the rotations that they made, only keeping Thrall and Sylvanas, it might be too greedy here with the rotations. I guess Zul, for Mindsanity, decided to go to bottom instead, but that could have been something Mindsanity could have capitalized on, getting very aggressive here with their decision-making for Gale Force.
Going to take another Punisher. Very, very nicely done here by Gale Force at the moment. And I think a lot of people come into this series being like, well, Mindsanity, they're actually just fantastically strong at the moment in terms of coordination. But it hasn't looked on point at the moment against Gale Force. That front line hasn't synergized well enough just yet here for them. I don't even think Poison Nova's really done much at all during these fights.
No, it hasn't. I think one thing, Mindsanity hasn't been able to get the counter engaged. They have Gust, and they also are going to have, like, if a Anubarak can be able to survive his Locust Swarm, everything they're counter engage is great. The problem is people are just dying on the first approach to the initiation. Falsehead is not able to isolate or do anything when it came to the disengage so far in this match, and it's really hurting them now. So now the sidewall taken.
Oh, for Fury, what a brilliant follow-up. The palm's going to go on towards Blumby. It doesn't get activated, though. He actually burrows on away. He might have been even better not burrowing away in that situation, considering, but that follow-up from Fury was absolutely blistering on towards Mindsanity.
Yeah, that's something Gale Force has actually taken away from the Chinese team. Actually, the double Punisher leap here. Darkmok going in with a great spin. Thrall will be able to get the interrupt with Sundering.
Ancestral Heal on towards Fury as well. He will be kept alive. Darkmok is looking for the pursuit. Nurok, does he have a Bone Prism to try and get him? Doesn't look like he will. And they're going to have to fall back here for now. Two of their members just a little bit lower. Gale Force, Esports, ahead in the experience, ahead in structural integrity as well on the map.
But they're getting the party bush here. Ooh. They know they're on the camp here. They're going to engage here. Keep in mind, Locust Swarm and Mosh Pit are still available. He's going to be going down. He's just getting squashed here.
Yeah.
At left and right, the solo tank Anubarak is not able to survive this, and just the combos are all it takes.
You're right. Fury and Crowan are just the fly swatter to our Anubarak. Just get out of, stop buzzing around our heads and die already. It's so impressive. They just keep getting these combos follow up time and time again.
Yeah, they are doing a great job here. And now they have an entire level lead over Mindsanity here, now knocking onto the key front wall with Sylvanas being able to cripple it. Uh-oh. And the Shaman Camp. Good, great pre-cleanse, though.
Very, very good. That could have easily killed off Darkmog there instantaneously. They're even shutting down this, and it can do a little bit more damage. But for now, they're going to back off. They don't want any more of this. They didn't have the wave with them. Gale Force keeps the aggression on.
And that's actually really great decision-making coming out from Gale Force. Obviously, they're pushing their lead as best as they possibly can, but they have kind of been known to maybe bite off a little bit more than they can chew there, knowing the second that Anubarak can spawn, not risking positioning for the great flight coming out from Falsehead and getting a gust and forcing a bad fight for them. So they are definitely making the proper decisions here, showing that after a little bit of rest, they're more on their game than they were day one.
Oh, for sure. I mean, like, you don't always have vision of a Falstad if he's down near that, and then you don't want him to, like, randomly fly behind you, gust you all in that kind of situation as well. That would be absolutely devastating. But new Shrine on, and I think the Mindsanity should be able to get 16 before this gets too far. There's 30 seconds left alive before this actually pops.
Yeah, they'll be able to get it, and even if they don't, they're going to have Falstad here, so it's not enough of an XP advantage for them to be worried about it too much at the time. The only thing to really be looking out for is going to be the Shaman Camps are spawning closer for Gale Force in 45 seconds, but that's not reasonable for the time being for them. That's the only advantage they can get here, so this will be another even footing fight for Gale Force versus Mindsanity here. And again,
damage.
The bug.
Oh, he's going to get squashed, and he does. He goes down. Gale Force are fully exploiting Anubarak in this situation. They are absolutely popping him. They do not care about damper magic, and well played by them indeed. As now, Mindsanity has to fall back. And it's almost a guaranteed shrine now with them being able to pick off Anubarak each single time. Blumby has not been on point this game.
I mean, it's just Mindsanity has to be with every single individual every time they go into a team fight here. When a Nubarak gets all the CC burnt onto them, they need to have the counter engage. Like, Palm has to be hit onto him. Then they're going to have to get the Poison Nova and Sonya get the engage, or at least a gust to get away from it here. But they have done none of those things in any of these situations. Every team fight, it feels like somebody is just losing their health before anything really even matters now. And Gelfor is going with a split push here with this Immortal. Guess what? Nurok, though, is going to be sniffed out here. No hard CC up quite yet.
And they're actually able to catch him with the Wolf. Sundering comes out as well. They're going to go straight on towards him. This might be a little bit of an overextension, though. Anubrak is back here. That's a great palm on towards Yudar, but at the same time, they're going to fall there, and they will actually take a massive, massive blow there to their team. They went so deep for that kill. Let's take a look at that once again. I said palm on towards Yudal. I was a bit preoccupied there. It was on towards Nurok, of course, on that side, but that was a blistering fight out of Mayan Sanity because Gale Force overextended.
Yeah, Gale Force was doing a really smart choice, trying to threaten the top keep with Sylvanas while the Punisher pushes on bottom. But the minute that they saw Nurok got too bloodthirsty, and I mean, diving a fort that early on with a great gust coming out from Hasu up there, very unrealistic for them to gain anything, and now turning the tides for Mayan Sanity.
I mean, Drake, correct me if I'm wrong, but in Heroes of the Storm here, Gale Force Esports in this game, we're almost in the driving seat the whole time.
Yes.
That one fight can turn everything around.
It was the one fight that turned everything around, but one thing to keep in mind when we approach this is if Mayan Sanity, obviously morale's got to be a little bit better after seeing that team fight there, but there's no way that they sit there and don't go, well, that was probably a little bit too aggressive a decision.
Yes,
and
yes.
Other than the XP advantage that they've been able to get off of that small mistake coming out from Gale Force here, there's still no reason for me to believe that this team fights aren't going to be happening the exact same way they
still
were up for the first 14 minutes of this match.
Yeah, unless Blumby changes something about his current engagement position. And something as a small note to take here as well when we look at talents is Blumby actually goes for blood at 16 over Epicenter, which is a regional thing. In Europe, we like more blood for blood on Anubarak compared to the Epicenter, which is far more common in NA, I would say.
Rafflecopter, they're trying to bait him and try and get split push here. They know they're going to be on the Shaman camp. Mayan Sanity might try and force this keep. It would be a smart choice because they aren't going to get a fight before 20 except for this one here. So Mayan Sanity is probably going to try and not engage, but with Sylvanas and a Shaman camp, they should be able to get it.
But look where Hasu's positioning himself. He's trying to stay out of vision. Oh, Yudal goes for the Sundering across the wall there. Splendor taking quite a bit of damage. He will keep himself alive during all of that. Blumby likewise pushing these guys back. And Akaface will end up going down. Once again, a little bit of an over an extension here for them and flying on forwards. Rufflecopter's already used his Haunting Wave. He almost goes down to that. And he will get away very, very importantly.
Yeah, that was a very aggressive Sunder and approach over the wall there. I think they were trying to just get the instant pick with an ETC follow-up here. But now with one person down, Mayan Sanity is on the hunt here, getting the chase here. It looks like they're actually going to be moving for Merc pressure only, knowing that one person is down here. Just denial of the pressure on their opponents is better than anything. They're about to hit 20. There is nothing to be worrying about for them currently.
Yep. Mayan Sanity making the recovery here at the moment, but can't help but feel it is from the Gale Force mistakes as they were fully in control during all of that. And we do have these level 20s coming in with Hardened Shield, Epic Mount, Peaceful Riposte, Ignore Pain, and Mortal Wound. So it's got to be very, very careful about the healing potential going down onto some of these members with the fact that Mortal Wound is now active.
That is actually the second team fight we've seen Mike Udall be very aggressive with the Sundering and a turning positioning and everything being essentially thrown out of the window for Gale Force Esports.
Didn't go well.
They've just seen the Sundering. They're trying to make those big plays, and I can't help but question whether or not that was because of their momentum that they got very early in this match.
Well.
And then now it might be carrying over a little bit too much here, giving Mayan Sanity a level, not only a level advantage, but 20 advantage, while these Punishers are now scaling enough to hurt.
Yeah, this is almost impossible for them to rival. So you can already see that down towards the bottom here, Gale Force is going to prioritize other things instead of trying to go for that Shrine, knowing that they need to catch up an experience. But, I mean, I've got to agree with you. I mean, that Sundering that we saw in that last fight, very an unconventional usage of it, considering.
I don't think it was the worst in the world. I think that just everybody wasn't on the same plane. I feel like it was going to be isolation onto Splendor with the ETC follow-up, but it just didn't knock them into the proper range. And then with the gust coming into play as well, it just turned very quickly against GFE here. So now, the Punisher is going to be moving in favor of Mayan Sanity. No surprise, considering they have 20 advantage. I am curious why nobody has gone on to clear the camp on bottom here, it's going to gain a little bit of value because My Insanity is going to want to secure this keep minimum.
Yes.
With this Punisher.
Yeah. Falstaff could have been a very, very good choice to try and do this.
Yeah.
But for now, Mortar Punisher will be active.
There he goes.
Level 20, not active yet for Gale Force. Falstaff has gone to the bottom, as we just mentioned, and this is going to be a little bit deadly. This is a good window here for My Insanity to do big, big damage.
Yeah, they're going to be focusing this sidewall probably in order to try and get the damage out, but for the time being, Falstead actually not clearing the Shaman camp or the camp pushing on bottom completely, so it will gain a little bit of value. There's the sidewall.
Darkmoor goes in, actually spears on towards Crowan, half health at the moment here, so got to be very careful for him. He does have a barrier available if he needs it, of course. Phoenix is going to buy a little bit more time, but the Punisher, actually not that healthy anymore. They've done a really, really good job of stalling this out at the moment. They still don't have 20, though. Darkmoor goes in a little bit further, tries to do some damage on towards Fury, but here comes Fury with the Mosh. Oh, the Falstad able to get that wind down very, very quickly. The gust will push him away. That was very, very close. If Falstad had been caught during all of that, they will get themselves a keep.
Yeah, they do end up getting the keep here, but they're still not 20. You know that they want this fight for the time being because the cooldowns, only Gust and Wrath have been burnt for them. Sundering's the only one available. Oh. They try to go on to Nurok here, Claris.
They missed the gravity lap, so now they've got to be very careful. Do Gale Force about actually taking this fight. It's off cooldown at the moment, so it really needs to fall on back.
That damage coming out from Hasuwabs there, the harass was huge here. And you still see Gale Force Esports is aggressing here. That does not seem like a smart choice for the time being. They don't have a lot of their stuff, but here comes the party bush. Darkmoth is going to be able to turn Fury, taking a lot of damage here.
And he will go back there. Sundering saves him for a little bit longer as well. The Wolf actually comes out from Mike Udall towards the bottom. Doesn't quite catch Darkmoth there on the retreat out. And looks like both teams are going to have to back off. What a start to this series, Dread.
Yeah, this has been phenomenal play from both of these teams. Just dancing back and forth, it feels like here. It's really impressive, honestly. It feels like we see a new version of Gale Force Esports going into this matchup.
Agree.
Both of them now securing the Shaman camp here. Both have 20 that are just, honestly, it's going to be coming down to getting the pressure and then waiting for the next shrine because it's very difficult, as we've seen with Gale Force trying to take out the keeps here, to make those major rotational plays like you can on maps like Cursed Hollow.
And as much as, you know, I like the fact that we're seeing the strong level 20s from My Insanity, triple blink on the side here from Gale Force means that plays can certainly happen. Blink into Sundering, blink into Marsh, like if needs be. All of these are huge, huge game changers. So Gale Force has gained some traction. Yes, they've lost one keep. But now this shrine can be very, very level pegging going into it.
Yeah, and in 18 seconds, all the heroics will be up for every single team. Everyone has pressure in every lane here. They do smell it out.
Yep.
And try to. They're going to give the invade here. I don't think Mind Sanity is going to even contest.
They can gust to try and contest if they want.
It's not worth, though, knowing that the big team fight's going to be up in a moment, right?
I completely agree. Also, the fact that Amplify Damage is there for Bone Prism is that technically, Nurok wanting to land that and try and get a pick off on someone is their best chance to blow someone up during all of this without having to deal with ancestral healing. Ancestral healing.
Oh, there goes the bug, and the cleanse is going to be able to come out here, so he gets the burrow over the wall to keep him alive there. So right now, for the time being, the combo is off cooldown.
But look how slow they are. Like, the other shrine fights have been pretty quick.
Yes.
But both teams know that this could be do or die. This situation, Fury's gone quite far in here. Darkmoth trying to, and actually that gust is going to push back three of them. They're going to get the blow up on towards ETC. That's the perfect move there for My Insanity to start snowballing this out of control. Rufflecopter trying to Haunting Wave twice. Away will get away, but that many Neves on the other side. The Palm is able to hit Darkmoth just at the very last second for him to stay alive. Rhaegar goes down. GFE has to be in full retreat, but Sylvanas tried to come back in to get into this, and now it looks like Crowan is probably going to fall as well. My Insanity took a great fight here.
Yeah, it was phenomenal. Everything that they did in that situation essentially secures them the game at this point with four members going down. Mike Udall doesn't have anything. He's going to try and get a pick here. If they overextend in the situation, the flight's going to come out, but I don't think he's going to be able to stop it. Falstad is already going to the core here, so all it took was just one great interrupt onto the mosh pit in that chokehold there, and My Insanity was able to clean up the rest of that team fight here and win game number one.
Yeah, that is going to be the core falling here unless Mike Udall can pull a rabbit out of his hat, but I don't think so. What a game to start off this series. Gale Force Esports showed a brilliant start to it, but just a few fights here and there, a few overextensions, and now My Insanity will take game number one on Battlefield of Eternity.
I mean, The one thing to keep in mind, like when we see this first game, is just I don't think anybody expected Galeforce Esports to come out as aggressive and calculated as they were. I mean, up until that one moment, you never, like, the entire game felt like it was in their control. It was just diving the mid for it was a little bit too much.
Yeah, that's true. Infernal Shrines, of course, being that map. But that was a really good start to the series.
Yes.
I'm very impressed by what we saw from Galeforce, as you're mentioning. The way in which they approached that series was really cool. But even the fortitude that we saw out of My Insanity in the end, not getting tilted, knowing that if their opponents do overextend in those situations, they were able to punish it pretty well and then not drop the ball from there, which was cool.
Yeah, with an experienced team like that, I expect that, I guess, from them at this point. But it shows that even at the top level that they can keep their minds in the right place and be able to secure it. So very well done. I'm excited for game two.
Likewise, so am I. And I imagine our panel is as well. Let's head over to them to hear what their thoughts are on our first game.